In the world of internal combustion engines, we're used to seeing a handful of different configurations. We've got V engines, inline engines, flat engines, and even in some weird vehicles, we've got things like the Wankel rotary. But what if I told you in the 1970s, Honda went way out of their way to do something super duper weird. And that's instead of using circular pistons, they went ahead and used oval pistons. I know it sounds crazy, but it is true. Back in the 1970s, Honda spent a lot of time and a lot of money developing an oval piston engine. So today we're going to take a deep dive into it. We're going to look at what's good with it, what's bad with it, and ultimately why it failed. Roll that intro. To get this story started, we have to rewind the clock to the late 1970s, where Honda had been absent from Grand Prix racing since the 1960s, and more specifically about 12 years. So in 1979, they re-entered the Grand Prix racing stage. But the thing is, at that time, pretty much all the motorcycles that were dominating were two-strokes. While two-stroke bikes are cool, and at that time made considerably more power than the average four-stroke engine, Honda didn't like them, straight up calling them a bamboo tube with holes drilled in it at one point. I think it's also worth noting that it's not just that Honda didn't like two-stroke engines, but also that they'd previously had success with four-stroke racing engines when everyone else said it couldn't be done. Dating back some of the earliest years with motorcycle racing, they went against the convention of two-stroke engines, and the idea of a four-stroke engine that could actually win races became synonymous with the Honda name. I think it's also worth noting that they did use two-stroke engines throughout their racing history, but this time around, they really wanted to avoid them at all costs. Well, maybe not that extreme. But the point is, Honda didn't want to use a two-stroke engine, they wanted to use a four-stroke, and they had already previously shown the world that dominating races with a four-stroke engine was possible with the right engineer. So when it came time to re-enter the Grand Prix racing stage, a four-stroke engine was an obvious choice for Honda. They didn't want to go with anything less. The only problem was, four-strokes, plain and simple, were at a disadvantage to compete with two-stroke engines in terms of power and weight at that time. At the end of the day, two-strokes are really good at making power while also having very minimal weight. So, if Honda wanted to dominate and not just compete, some serious innovation was needed. And this is where the oval engine comes into play. This is also where Toshimitsu Yoshimura comes into play as one of the key engineers behind the NR500 motorcycle and the oval engine inside of it. Interestingly enough though, as one of the key engineers for this engine, he had no previous racing experience with Honda and had only been with them for 6 short years. Quote, "Instead of being excited about developing racing machines, our feeling was more akin to raw determination. It was the determination to create something that would represent the very best in technology. We were determined to create an engine to surprise the whole world. We believed that if we could create the best engine, it would bring us victory." That brings us to the World GP racing regulations at that time, which limited engines to 4 cylinders. And in order for a 4-stroke to be as powerful as a 2-stroke, it's generally going to have to spin twice as fast. So if a 2-stroke's at 10,000 RPM, you need this 4-stroke to spin at 20,000 RPM to make up for the fact that a 4-stroke has half as many combustion cycles per 4 strokes as compared to a 2-stroke. With that in mind, heat resistance, low friction, and intake efficiency were at the top of the priority list for developing this new oval engine. And because this was such a young and relatively inexperienced development team, they weren't necessarily afraid to try crazy stuff, because the notion that something couldn't be done didn't really exist to them. And this is where the idea of having 8 valves per cylinder came into play. But how are you going to fit 8 valves next to each other with a circular piston? You don't. Instead, you elongate the piston to an oval in order to fit all the valves. Quote, "We had nothing to fear. You could even say we had no preconceived notion that a piston had to have a circular cross-section. We were determined that the oval design was the key to outperforming two-stroke engines." Now, I'm not exactly sure how Honda calculated, but according to them, their calculations showed that their 4-stroke oval piston engine should be able to produce 130 horsepower at 23,000 RPM, which would give them a decent leg up on their competition, because a lot of the 2-stroke bikes at that time were producing around 120 horsepower, and a 10 horsepower jump is huge when you're talking about a motorcycle. Of course, calculations are just that, and getting something to work in the real world isn't always as easy as it is to get it to work on paper or in a simulation. With an oval piston, there's a lot of challenges around sealing, friction, piston stability, and more. They started with a single cylinder, 2-valve oval piston engine, and eventually got that to work. And as development continued, they eventually increased up to the planned 8 valves per cylinder. Some of the hurdles that they had to get over during the development process include a, quote, sudden disintegration. Now, this would happen because the connecting rods twist when the engine's at really, really high speed. You get a little bit of twisting on them. But the issue is, on this engine, with an oval piston, you have 2 connecting rods. So if they twist differently than each other, you have a lot of binding in there and a lot of friction in your system, which is eventually going to lead to things exploding when you're spinning at 20,000 RPM. That also brings up the piston ring, where on a normal circular piston, it's a pretty easy thing to machine and have precisely fit on the piston and inside the cylinder. But when you elongate said circular piston into an oval, now you have to figure out how to machine piston rings that properly seal that piston. According to Honda, this was one of the more difficult parts of the development process for the oval piston engine, because not only was it hard to design something that would work for an oval piston, it was also just flat out hard to machine it, because the machines that they had back then weren't as precise or as accurate as the machines that we have today. After testing dozens of different designs, they actually settled for something fairly simple and fairly basic as compared to some of the things that they were testing, but they were able to get the piston rings to seal with a lot of development. But lo and behold, after much time spent on their development, the engine was finally functioning and ready to hit the races, which is where the 0X engine comes into play. Ironically, development still wasn't actually completed, and they were dealing with some failing parts. So for some reason, they thought the better development bed would be to install it in a racing machine before it was exactly ready. Unsurprisingly, the first race was a complete failure. Honda barely qualified for the race, and with 2 bikes entered, one of them crashed on the very first corner, and the other one retired after just a few laps because of engine trouble. A little bit later on, at the final race of the season, Honda failed to even qualify for the main race. So you could say right off the bat, they weren't able to get their crazy engine to perform the way that they wanted. Not only were they dealing with a lot of reliability issues, but they were also struggling to get the engine to produce that projected 130 horsepower at 23,000 RPM. Which meant that even when the engine was working, it wasn't making the power that it needed in order to compete. So even if it didn't blow up, you still weren't going to be competing for a title or a championship or even a singular race. That takes us forward to 1981, where Honda moved from the 0X engine to the 2X engine and actually saw their first victory at the 1981 Suzuka 500 kilometer race. But even though they finally had their very first win, and they were finally able to get the engine to start producing the power that they had been aiming for the whole time, they were still struggling to compete in races. More specifically, they were struggling with weight, which is one of the big benefits of a 2-stroke engine all of their competitors were using at the time. They tried to solve some of these weight issues by using aluminum and titanium parts rather than iron or already lightweight magnesium, but even then, they were at a disadvantage. At this point, it had been 3 years since Honda had re-entered the Grand Prix racing stage on the global scale. And during that time, they had 0 wins on the international stage. And as such, they got really tired of losing, understandably so. No one wants to race and constantly lose. So in 1982, they introduced the NS500 motorcycle, which was designed as a replacement, or not really a replacement, but a bike to run alongside the NR500 oval piston engine. And funny enough, the new NS500 motorcycles went against everything that they had been working towards by using a 2-stroke engine. With those new bikes though, Honda began to dominate in racing for years to come, leaving the oval 4-stroke engine behind in the graveyard. That being said, Honda did eventually have the oval 3X engine, which should have been the perfect engine. It should have solved all the reliability issues, it should have made the power that they wanted to, it should have blown the doors off of the 2X and 0X engines. But unfortunately, with the success of the NS500 motorcycles, the NR500 with the 3X engine never got to see a singular race, even though it probably would have been even better than their NS500 bikes. And that takes us off the racetrack, away from the NR500 and NR750 race bikes to the NR750 road-going bikes, where all the development Honda had been working on was finally put into a, quote, mass production machine. What made the road-going bike different than the race bikes was a decreased V-angle, and most notably, an elliptical piston rather than an oval piston. Understandably, many of these road-going bikes were dealing with the same reliability issues or very similar reliability issues as the NR500 and NR750 race bikes, and getting parts for a bike with a unique engine that had never been used ever since then is a little bit difficult. So understandably, a lot of the NR750 road-going bikes were quickly retired and quickly became collector's items. In fact, one of them was recently for sale. But besides just that, they barely produced any of the road-going bikes in the first place, so kind of off the get, they were just a collector's item. They were weird, they were rare, and they were expensive, and they had a very weird engine design. So that's the story of Honda's crazy oval piston bike, or oval piston engine. And it's kind of cool to see these kinds of funky forms of development and experimentation. We really don't see this kind of stuff anymore with motorcycles or cars or F1 or anything like that. With modern technology, simulations have gotten a lot better. So we've gotten a lot better at dialing down on thermal efficiency and just making engines produce power without having to try these super weird configurations like a big bore or a big stroke or an oval piston or a rotary. None of that stuff really has to be tested anymore because we know through a lot of simulation what works and what doesn't. But regardless of that, it is super cool to look back and see some of these goofy engine setups like the oval piston engine and why they didn't work. If you guys enjoyed this video, be sure to smash the thumbs up button, get subscribed so you don't miss out on future videos. Check out some of the other stuff on the channel. Drop a comment down below. Let me know what you want to see in the future, and I'll see you guys in the next one.